Welcome to the teaching ministry of Joyce Meyer. This teaching is titled, Your Mouth and God's Power.
All right. I have a grandson that's a little over three, and he had gotten a hold of a bunch of pictures of me from a photo session I had done, and so he put stickers on the pictures for me, and I know you can't see this, but you get the point. When he brought it to my house to surprise me, every sticker was over my mouth. I mean, every picture, the sticker's over my mouth. I thought, well, God, are you trying to tell me something? This is an area where we will always be growing our whole life. It amazes me the number of years that I sat in church and never heard anything about the power of my words. Maybe you've heard teaching like this before. It doesn't matter to me. If you've heard it 100 times, you need to hear it again. Because there's no area that's harder to control than our mouth. No man can tame the tongue, the Bible says. You say, well, then if I can't tame my tongue, what's the point in teaching me to? Well, here's the thing. If you want to, if you really want to do what's right and use your mouth for a godly purpose, and if you'll pray about it, and if you will study in this area, God will do the work that needs to be done. But don't think that you can just make a decision to go home and shut up and everything is going to change, because I went through that over and over, and I actually got worse instead of better. We cannot change by works of the flesh. We can only change when we let the Holy Spirit work in our life to bring the changes that need to be brought. You and God are partners, and you cannot do it without Him. God's not going to let us have victories without Him, because if we try to, then we're going to take the credit. Tonight in particular, I want to talk to you about words and how they affect the anointing on your life, or how they affect the power and the presence of God on your life. I went to church for a lot of years, and I never heard anything about the power of God. I never really heard the word anointing. And that's sad, because the Holy Spirit brings the anointing of God into our lives. And that anointing, that power, that presence of God on our lives, in our lives and on our lives, is one of the most precious gifts that we have. The presence of God in your life, the power of God that is in you and on you for whatever you need to do, is the most precious thing that you have in your life, and you must protect it. The power of God on our lives needs to be reverenced, honored, and protected. And one of the ways that we can do great damage to that beautiful anointing is by having a mixture in our life. Praising God when we're in church and singing all these songs and quoting scriptures and hearing the word, and then going out and gossiping about people and being judgmental and critical and negative and murmuring and complaining and speaking all kinds of doubt and unbelief. Are we all together on the same page? We need to get rid of the mixture. You say a few things good and the power starts to increase in your life, then you say a few things negative and it decreases and goes back to zero. We have to get consistent in saying what God says. It's not about just saying anything we want to say, but learning how to say what God says. And no matter how impossible it seems to us, when we read one of God's promises in the Word, the only thing that He wants to hear from us is, I agree with you, God. If you say that you can do that, then I believe that you can do that. It may be impossible with man, but all things are possible with God. We have to learn how to come into agreement with God. Some of you are sitting in church week after week, and you're watching my program, and you've even come to this conference, and you so desperately need God to work in your life, and you want to. But I can tell you, it was this way in my life, and I'm not trying to insult you. I'm trying to help you. You just keep digging in deeper with your own mouth. It doesn't do any good just to hear somebody say it. You've got to learn to say what God says. The whole reason to hear the Word of God is so you can learn to say what God says. The Word of God in your mouth, spoken out loud in faith, is your number one most powerful weapon against the enemy. If you want to defeat the devil, you have to learn how to speak the Word. Not speak what you feel, not speak what you think, not speak what people tell you, but the Word of God. Anybody can have the promises of God fulfilled in their lives if they will learn how to come into agreement with God, to do what God tells you to do and to say what God says. Amen. Proverbs 18:21 says, the power of life and death are in the tongue. Now we're going to look at those scriptures a little more completely in other messages. Tonight I'm going to kind of lay a foundation and talk to you about this, the anointing on our lives and the importance of maintaining that anointing. I think today there's probably even a good number of people that don't even really know what the anointing is. Well, Christ is called the Anointed One. That's what the word Christ means, the Anointed One. Jesus, the Anointed One, and the anointing, the power of God. The Holy Spirit was sent to represent Jesus when Jesus went to heaven to sit at the Father's right hand. He is the presence of God. When we feel the presence of God, when we're singing these beautiful worship songs, that's the Holy Spirit in our midst. When you feel or sense the power of God on you to do something that you need to do, that's the presence of God coming on your life to help you and enable you to do what you need to do. And the more you agree with God, the more power is going to be released in your life. Let's look at Luke 1, verse 11. I could tell by the way you guys groaned that you need this message. How many of you will be glad to hear four good messages on the power of your words? Luke 1, beginning in verse 11. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing at the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled and fear took possession of him. But the angel said to him, don't be afraid, Zechariah, because your petition was heard and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son. Now, he's been praying for something that when God tells him he's about to get it, he won't believe God. Have you ever prayed for something and then when you get it, you say, I just can't believe that? Well, why are we praying if we're not expecting and believing God to do something? Your petition has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will call his name John, which means God is favorable. And you shall have joy and exultant delight, and many will rejoice over his birth, for he will be great and distinguished in the sight of the Lord. And he must drink no wine nor strong drink, and he will be filled with and controlled by the Holy Spirit, even in and from his mother's womb. And he will turn back and cause to return many of the sons of Israel to the Lord their God. And I mean, right about now, Zacharias should have been just hopping up and down inside like, whoa, praise the Lord, exceedingly abundantly above and beyond. I just asked for a child, but I'm going to get a famous one. Verse 17, and he will himself go before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah, him, he was talking about the Savior, to turn back the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient and the incredulous and the unpersuadable to the wisdom of the upright, which is the knowledge and the holy love of the will of God, in order to make ready for the Lord a people perfectly prepared in spirit, adjusted and disposed and placed in the right moral state. He's telling him, and your son, this child that you've prayed for, is going to be the forerunner for the Savior. He's going to go ahead of him and prepare the way. And Zacharias said to the angel, verse 18, by what shall I know and be sure of this? Prove it to me, God. For I am an old man and my wife is well advanced in years. So here he's been praying for a child, but he already thinks he's too old to have one. He thinks his wife is too old. So look what happens. And the angel replied to him, I am Gabriel. I stand in the very presence of God, and I have been sent to talk to you and to bring you this good news. Now behold, you will be and will continue to be silent and not able to speak until the day when these things take place, because you have not believed what I told you, but my words are of a kind which will be fulfilled in the appointed and the proper time. So God supernaturally shut Zechariah's mouth. And I wouldn't mind to have a little of that sometime myself. Amen. And he had to do it in order for his plan to come to pass in his life. The birth of this child was so important as a forerunner to the Messiah, and he could see, the angel could see from Zechariah's initial response and his first words that there was not much chance of that man verbally cooperating with the plan of God, and so God had to shut his mouth. And I just wonder how many of us mess up the plan of God for our life. Come on now. I just wonder how many wonderful things God has had planned and how many things he has planned now that if you were not at this conference, you would surely mess up by saying things that you shouldn't say. But thank God, because you're here this weekend, God is not going to have to supernaturally shut your mouth. You are going to learn. Is anybody with me tonight? How many of you see that? Well, I guess I just better shut your mouth right now, or we're never going to get this done. Our words are so, so important. Everything in the Bible is important, but there are some things that stand out to me. The power of our thoughts are extremely important because our thoughts become words. And of all the teaching that we put on television, the three areas that people respond to the most are the mouth, the mind, and emotions. I think we all know that those are areas that tend to give us a lot of trouble. The mind is the battlefield. Your thoughts are where Satan attacks you. The Bible says that out of the heart, what's in your mind, comes out of your mouth. So naturally, Satan wants to put wrong thoughts in your mind, hoping that you will speak wrong things out of your mouth. I was thinking even just about exhortation. I'm going to talk some this weekend about what a powerful ministry it is just to encourage people and how desperately that is so much more needed today. And you know, when people see me out and about, I frequently get compliments, but I was thinking literally almost every person who comes up to me to give me a compliment starts this way. I know you probably hear this all the time, but. And I was thinking today, you know what? I believe that even that is a clear example that here's a person, God puts it in their heart to encourage. And the enemy right away puts a thought in their mind, oh, she hears that stuff all the time. She don't want to hear what you have to say. We have to be so careful that we don't let the devil talk us out of doing what God wants us to do in our lives. Pay attention to what you're thinking and pay attention to what you're saying. Luke 10:19. Oh, the anointing is so wonderful, and we need to learn how to depend on the anointing. Depend on the power of God. Apart from him, we can do nothing. Luke 10:19. Behold, I have given you authority and power. Not I will, I might, could be, hope so, maybe. I have given you. Every one of you that is a child of God, every person here watching by TV, listening in some way, if you're a child of God, you have authority and power. It's been given to you by God. Power to trample on serpents and scorpions and physical and mental strength and ability over all the power that the enemy possesses, and nothing shall in any way harm you. Now, I'm sure some people think, well, yeah, if I got so much power, then why is my life such a mess? Because you can kill the power of God in your life. You can press it down, hinder it, keep it from flowing by speaking things that are not in agreement with God's plan and will for your life. God has equipped us, now listen to me, God has equipped us on the inside in our spirit with every single thing that we need to live a victorious life. Everything. When you're born again, the seed of God comes to live in you. That means that you're pregnant with everything that God is. In your womb, When a woman becomes pregnant, her husband's seed is planted in her womb, and the child grows and grows and grows and grows and develops, and then it gives birth. Well, that's what happens when we receive Christ. We receive a seed of peace, a seed of righteousness, a seed of joy. Everything comes to us as a seed. And as we water it with the Word of God, and we let the Holy Spirit work in our lives to pull the weeds out of our life, and as we grow and we grow and we grow, then one thing after another, we give birth to these beautiful things that God has put in our life, and they become our experience rather than something we just read about and never experience. How many of you understand what I'm saying? So you don't even have to pray for peace. You've got peace. You need to pray that God will teach you how to walk in the peace that you have. You don't have to pray, oh God, I need joy. You say, no, God, I believe your joy is in me. Teach me how to not give up my joy. Teach me how to not let the devil steal my joy. We don't need to keep praying for something we've already got. We need to start making use out of it. You don't need to pray, God, give me power. You say, God, I believe that I have power on the inside of me. I'm agreeing with you. I believe that I have power on the inside of me. Now teach me how to walk in that power. You'll be amazed at how much different you'll feel if you'll just start to think and speak about what you already have. I mean, you'll just be like, I have power. Wow, I'm anointed. I have abilities. Instead of going around, I don't have any power, I don't have any peace, I don't have any joy, and nobody loves me. Oh, come on, we are going to have too much fun this weekend. The power of life and death is in the tongue. You can turn your future around by learning how to say what God says. This is a very important thing for you to hear. And every one of your friends that has a big mouth, you need to go get them and bring them back here tomorrow. Offer to feed them. Anybody will do anything if you'll feed them. So we have power. But where's it at? Well, the Lord wants to increase the release of this power in your life. He wants you to experience more of that power. He wants you to walk in the fullness of the anointing that you have. Let's look at James 3. The first 10 verses of James chapter 3, you could read them every day and never stop learning something about what it says. James 3:1 says, not many of you should become teachers and self-constituted censors and reprovers of others. And we do like to tell other people what to do, don't we? My brethren. For you know that we teachers will be judged by a higher standard and with a greater severity than other people. Thus we assume the greater accountability and the more condemnation. Now I will tell you, that scripture puts the fear of God in me. The second verse says, for we all often stumble and fall and offend in many things. And if anyone does not offend in speech, never says the wrong things, he's a fully developed character and a perfect man, able to control his whole body and curb his entire nature. So he's basically saying that anybody that can control their mouth has developed mature spiritual character. You can locate where anybody is at spiritually in their walk with God by just listening to them. Not just in church. Probably don't even want to listen there because everybody's spiritual there. But in everyday life, when they have a problem, when something doesn't happen as fast as they'd like it to, when somebody aggravates them or irritates them. Not many of you should become teachers. Now there's teachers like I'm a teacher. There's school teachers. Moms and dads are teaching their children all the time. But honestly and truly, we do really like to try to tell everybody what to do. So if you're going to be bold enough to try to teach somebody something, then the Bible says you better make sure that you're living it. Because for those who try to teach others, there's a greater accountability, a greater correction will come to you if you don't, than to somebody who doesn't have that responsibility. Now I'm going to tell you a story. One of the things that I've found for me, and this goes for every area, I should never judge anybody critically, but the worst person in the world for me to to speak against would be somebody else who's doing what I'm doing, somebody else who's teaching the word. Just like if you're a singer, the worst thing you could do would be to judge another singer. Well, I don't think they could, I don't like their voice. I don't think they can sing. Ooh, you better be careful. You better be careful. You're messing with your anointing. So years and years ago, before I got the wisdom that I have now through doing the wrong thing enough times and having a mess in my life that I finally learned it, wouldn't it be nice if we could just learn without getting beat up so many times, you know? How many messes have you made in your life with your mouth? Just because we wanted to say what we wanted to say. And what good did it do you? I mean, we've lost friends, we've lost jobs. And all of that is important, but let me tell you something. The thing that's the most important is messing up the anointing of God on your life. God anoints his people for great things. For great things. And whatever it is that you're anointed for, God wants you to be excellent at it. I mean, if you're a parent, then be a great parent. If you're a business owner, I mean, be a great business owner. Be a great boss. If I'm going to be a teacher of God's word, I want to be the very best that I can be. I don't want to be some mediocre anything or average anything. I want to be the best that I can be for God. Amen?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.